Hello, people. I'm pretty sure that the reason they put me as the last speaker was so that this year's Nordic Larp Talks would end on a note of great dignity. So, what's happening here is that in the book I wrote an article with this title, or a short little piece about the peace room and some other things. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to expand a little bit on those themes into a wider, maybe a little bit more serious subject. But I think the first thing you really need to know is that the peace room is not like a metaphor. It's like a real physical space. And it's, what's more, it's a real physical space in this very building, right here. It's on the same floor as those blue windows, but on the side of the light. Actually, it's under that window with the, which is lit on that side. Anyway, this is a LARP called The End of the Line, created by Martin Eriksson, Bjarke Pedersen, and myself in Helsinki a few years ago, a Vampire the Masquerade LARP. And this here was an abandoned building, a wonderful venue for the game. We wanted to have that underground techno party that's organized illegally feel, and an abandoned derelict building is great for that, because we thought if they are really organized in spaces like this, why don't we just get exactly the same space? So that's what we did. But there's some problems with abandoned buildings, and one of those problems is that the plumbing has stopped working some time ago. But the people have continued using it during that time. And those people, I think very sensibly, clearly had designated one room as the piss room. So it was not the entire building that smelled of piss, it was only one room in the building that smelled of piss, and was also full of piss. Piss was very present in this room. So when we were looking at this space and looking at our venue, we made a design choice. It's a question of, is it possible to let our players into the peace room? And we felt that that would be not good design. So instead, we designated the peace room as the organizer space. So during this LARP, I think that all of the players enjoyed LARPing in rooms that were distinctly devoid of piss. While I myself spent around 6 hours standing in the piss room. Now, unfortunately, in my career of LARP design, this is something of like a pattern of organizer spaces. In Halat, hisar in 2013, we had a venue that was almost big enough. So we thought, okay, we'll just use every single space for the players and then designate for organizer needs this closet, which was one square meter. And at one point, I remember I was myself in the closet, of very small closet. I was in the closet playing an NPC character. I was a New York Times journalist on the phone. And right next to me was another organizer who was writing new stuff on pieces of paper. And also our photographer was in the closet organizing his equipment. And this was very intimate LARP organizing happening in this closet. Then in Enlightenment in Blood, a big game we did in Berlin, also a vampire game, 200 players, over a dozen locations. But the one location we did not really pay enough attention to was the organizer backstage area. So as kind of like a Hail Mary move, we made a deal with a local game store that we were able to use the game store as our backspace area. So again, while people were LARPing in nightclubs and churches and all of these cool venues, meanwhile we were sitting next to guys painting Warhammer miniatures. And I especially remember one guy who painted like the entire time of the LARP, again like 6 hours, 7 hours, and we're having all these organizer discussions and all of that, and the guy is painting there like here, right at my elbow. So that's organizer spaces. But now I'm going to move into a slightly more serious topic. Enlightenment in blood. Like I mentioned, in Berlin, a vampire LARP, 200 players in over a dozen locations in Friedrichshain. We wanted to make it on a kind of a professional way, so we tried to put a lot of attention into how to maximize the value of our work hour, how to make a huge game with a small team. And I think we were quite successful in this, however, not without a cost. So, the creative lead of this LARP was me, and because we just simply could not find a proper producer in time, the production lead of this LARP was kind of also me. And then we thought that we used a system called LARP Weaver, where people assemble their characters out of blocks that are pre-created. So we write the stuff, but the player assembles the character out of those pieces. And a lot of that material, maybe 70%, was also written by me. And there were other people making this LARP who had a very critical role, but a lot of this was basically a very small team stuff. And those responsibilities start to pile up. Also, player communication, in large part on Facebook, again, this guy. And now we're getting closer to this slide. So it's maybe 5 days to the event. I'm in Berlin, in my hotel room. I have woken up. I've gone to the bathroom and sat down at the toilet to take a shit. And while I'm sitting there, my thoughts turn to LARP organizing. All of the things that have to be done, all of the player concerns that need to be addressed, all the problems we have with LARP Weaver that have to be fixed so that it works, all of our locations that are in a problematic state. And in this moment, I have the first panic attack of my life while taking a shit. And I can tell you right now that this is a very unideal moment to have your first panic attack. I don't know, some of you have experienced panic attacks, others haven't, but I think we can all imagine that it's better to have them at other moments of your life. So what happens there is that after I've calmed down, I have to do some cleaning, I have to take a shower, and then I go to my laptop and I do this Google search because I don't actually know what's happening. It's actually quite terrifying. But I had a guess. I thought, okay, this is what people are talking about. I mean, I remember these words, panic attack. So I Google it. I thought, okay, this matches. This makes sense. This is what happened to me. And then I thought, okay, so let's get to work. And then I look at an email, and then I have another panic attack. And maybe 10 more during that day. So during some of these panic attacks I was having, it quickly became obvious that even if, as I tried to even think about this LARP, my body put very kind of a strong resistance, very physical experience, the panic attack. So it was obvious I couldn't make a LARP. So then I communicated to the rest of the World of Darkness Berlin team that the team leader of this LARP is now on sick leave, unable to make this LARP. Turns out when you concentrate a lot of responsibility on one person, you also create kind of an information bottleneck. And if that person then has a panic attack every time they think about the LARP, that creates a very difficult flow of information for anybody who tries to pick up the slack in that situation. Fortunately, I had a very wonderful team, Bjarke Pedersen, Juhana Koljonen, who were making World of Darkness Berlin, also in the midst of their massive work crunch, took care of it, and the LARP happened, and I was able to physically be present at the game store backstage area to see it run, even if it was Johanna Koljonen who took the runtime lead role to make it actually work. And then, because I'm a very intelligent person, Later that year, we did another LARP called Parliament of Shadows with a slightly bigger core team, but with nevertheless, I repeated all of the same mistakes and had another burnout and total breakdown. And then I was Googling nervous breakdown symptoms, burnout symptoms. I learned a lot. But it was not great. So, what happens when the organizer is breaking down? People breaking down is bad. But somehow when you are in that moment, when you are designing the LARP, when it's your LARP, when you are in the team, you're feeling indispensable, you're thinking that this whole thing will collapse without your input, it's very hard to move yourself away or even lessen your workload in time. So I figured that I would just mention a few of the kind of negative consequences of total organizer collapse. For example, if the organizer is like totally fucked up, the quality of design and decision making, it drops. An organizer who is in the middle of a breakdown does not actually make great design decisions, especially important during runtime. And this leads straight to safety, because I think we can do safety with mechanics, but also organizers who do their stuff, who are rested, and you know, not having a breakdown, are often the best organizers to handle a crisis. While on the other hand, organizers who are like massively stressed and dying are not great at handling safety. And I've done this myself. Like, there's a safety crisis, and I'm just so exhausted, so I make a stupid call. That's bad. But the sort of the core cause of that is a lack of self-care and fucked up priorities. Another kind of, because for me, of course, this became like a whole year of mental health crisis, and it had a kind of a very subtle, but I felt in the end quite an insidious cost. And that's the next one, aversion to creative risk, or risk in general, or like conflict. The last LARP I did was called the Death by a Thousand Cuts, about climate change and class war. Basically a LARP about killing rich people. It was made in Finnish, in Finland. And I caught myself thinking that, you know, it's nice to make this LARP in Finland, in Finnish, so it's protected from international discourse by being made in a secret language. So if some person in some other side of the world might theoretically object to this theme of killing rich people, that person will never find about it, because it's in Finnish. But then I thought that this is not great. I mean, I do this stuff to communicate. I want games to be played, but also discussed, to inspire people, to sort of go out there. And this idea of surrendering to cowardice did not feel very good at all. And obviously, once my mental health started improving, I started noticing more of those things that I had lost during this time of crisis. And one of these was kind of a creative ability to take risks, to make things that are where it's possible that they cause some kind of a scandal or controversy or conflict or something like that. For example, there was a Palestinian lab designer who had asked me to help on a project that sounded super interesting, super important, also a little bit dangerous. And I had sort of waffled on that for like a year. And then when I realized that I was doing this for this reason, that my head couldn't take it before, then I thought, okay, what am I even doing? Why am I even here? And then I fired up a message to that guy and said, yes, I'm with you. But obviously, I will then in the future have to pay for that when I'm dealing with those scandals and crises. But hopefully I'm healthy when I do it. And I think also long-term community level damage. I mean, if everybody burns out, there's no LARPs. It's not great. And the human cost, you know, it sucks to be broken, basically. It's bad. It's unpleasant. But all is not doom and gloom, because after I came out of this hell year of breaking myself against the cliff of LARP, I decided that the next one is going to be a LARP that is not going to cause massive health damage to its organizers. So when we were making this LARP Death by 1,000 Cuts, me and Massi Hannula, we decided that this is going to like be like a healthy LARP project. It will be healthy for us when we make this. And these are personal solutions. I think this some stuff here works for others, but maybe not for you, maybe yes for you, I don't know. But this is what worked for me. One was when you allocate responsibilities in the team was just like allocate work hours, but also allocate stress. And if somebody finds something very stressful, maybe they should not do that. Maybe that should be done by somebody who does not find it so stressful. And me and Massi had a wonderful conversation where we basically established that she does not find LARP design, LARP producing stressful, and I do not find LARP design stressful. Like, I can do emergency design at 2 in the morning during runtime, and it will not kill me. So, but if I had to do emergency producing, it will kill me. So that's a very basic thing. But here I think the no moralizing clause is important because sometimes it's not very obvious, like, what is stressful for who. A very classic one is that, do you find it stressful to call people on the phone? Some people find it very stressful, other people totally normal. So I think it's best to be honest and just sort of accepting about people's limits. And sometimes when you have a very big thing that everybody finds like super hard to do, maybe that is a sign that you actually need a new person in this team. Because for us, for me, the big problem was that we didn't find the right LARP producer in time for Enlightenment in Blood, and that was not a thing. But the results of that were, the human cost of that was very, very, very big for me, basically. This is maybe a little bit controversial, but we also made a decision basically to avoid work-intensive design. So this means that if you put in like a massive amount of work to do this little thing for these two characters, cut it. And that's for everything. If it's like a small amount of work that will benefit 100 players, that's great. And this kind of simple benefit analysis of your time and your energy levels will make the whole thing better. And I think there is a kind of thing that a lot of LARP designers do, is that the LARP is in 2 days. And if you pull an all-nighter doing some kind of handcraft thing that will be an amazing prop, then the LARP will be great. And here, my feeling was, no, you spend that night sleeping. and those handcraft things will never be in the LARP, and that's it. If it's one month to the game, then maybe. But right before the game, you sleep. And make sure that team members are functional at runtime. I mean, rested, they have eaten food. I mean, this is very basic stuff, but I have failed at this like a gazillion times. And I'm not the only one. I'm not the only LARP burnout in this community. There's a lot of us. The last one is confront issues with the team. I just found that sometimes, especially when you're doing intense, stressful work, it's easy to just sort of try to get along and try to sort of just keep producing and ignore maybe just very personal issues, other stuff that's causing schism, but those can be very emotionally draining. Ah, I missed out the one on emotional labor. That's very tied to this, because that's also another thing, for example, with player communication or stuff like that, does not take a lot of time, does not take necessarily a lot of energy as such, but the emotional labor, the cost of that accumulates, and suddenly you're stressed out as hell. For me personally, but I think this might be just me, is that combining production responsibility and creative responsibility was like hell on earth. I don't know how this is for other people. Maybe you can do it, but I can't very demonstrably. So, however, I'm gonna go back to the beginning of this talk and back to the peace room. I think we all want to go there. Because the thing is that all of those things I talked about, like making a LARP in a way that destroys you, that's bad. We want to avoid that. We want, you know, not to be destroyed. But when me and Bjarke made the decision to make the player area piss-free and constrain ourselves to the piss room, we made the right call. And that is exactly the same call I would make again, because that's a reasonable cost. We think, okay, the LARP is going to be like this. Standing here is uncomfortable, but it will not kill me. It will not have adverse consequences the next day. So it's a reasonable sacrifice. So that's sort of the lesson I want to impart. Peace room, good. Self-destruction, bad.